Yudev, the only thing I would like to ask you is not to take this interview toward the dramatic, tragic side of the film.
You're a Lebanese director.
I am a Lebanese director who had grew up between Lebanon and the States, yeah.
And so Israel is not part of your life
Israel,
cycle?
Israel is a huge part of my cycle, but not on a friendly side. You know, I grew up in Lebanon, always considering Israel was the devil in itself, evil in itself. I mean, you know, we've been at war since 1948. What do you expect?
So do you have any kind of personal connection to the idea of somebody living on the other side of that and having the experience that this guy has in your movie?
Absolutely no. There is absolutely nobody that I knew personally, except a few acquaintances who are Palestinian, Israelis or Palestinian from the territories, which I've known. But the only thing that connects me to this film is the book. That's how it started. And the only thing that connects me to this whole area is I was born there.
You read the book coincidentally, or looking for a project?
Actually, my agent in New York, CIA at that time, called me and she says, there are an American production company interested to see your film, to discuss with you something. It's a book. I said, it's about what? She explained to me a little bit that its events takes place in the Middle East between the Israelis and the Palestinians. I said, look, Christina, I'm not interested. This conflict has taken a toll on me psychologically. It's difficult. I want to change my view of doing films, at least temporary, at least not now. I don't want to deal with the goddamn Middle East because I'm tired of it. She says, why don't you just read it? And then you don't want to, you don't want to do it. Mm-hmm. So she FedExed me. I took the book of an author called Yasmin Akadra, which I've never heard of him before. And I sat down at a coffee shop in Beirut on the beach, trashy place, but just I grew up there. And I was just mesmerized with it. I was really, really like so grasped by its human dimension and by its investigative scenes in the film. And just for you to know that the author, Yasmin Akadra, was the head of the intelligence apparatus, the head of intelligence unit in the Algerian army. The guy knew how to conduct interviews with Islamists and tough terrorists. And he was the colonel in the army. I mean, the guy is not an easy guy. So when you read these interrogation scenes and everything, there is so much truth to it. And at the same time, there's so much humanity to it. It's not an action thriller, but there's had a lot of thrilling to it. I finished it. I says, God damn, he nailed that guy. I can't let go of that book. This is a great book because not only the story was good, the characters, the structure was good. I mean, Yasmina is a very, very accomplished writer. He understands the three-act structure, whatever, everything. The only problem with the book is it's all written in the first person. So I start while I was reading it, before I even say yes, I said, if I want to adapt it, do I have to put a voiceover? Because the whole book is internal. You know, how is it? Well, I said, we'll see. I call Christina, says, I'm coming to New York. I fly to New York. I meet with the owner of this, the general manager of this company, which is a huge company, actually. Just unfortunately, I can't discuss what the company are because they made me sign a confidentiality agreement because it's a complicated issue. But I can't mention what it is. Otherwise, you know, they put me in a jail with a tiger or they break my back on a mountain or something.
I'd like to see that.
Yeah.
Not because I have anything against you, just because it would be, you know, amusing in and of itself. But okay. So
anyway, I met with the president of the company. Terrific guy, a great producer, great screenplay writer. I mean, I can't tell you the films that he has done. Gotta figure it out.
Okay, we'll do this some other. We'll figure it out off camera.
But we had a conversation very quickly. I told him how I wanted to adapt it, and then I asked him a question. I says, "Why are you an American Jew interested to make a movie that has no American actor, no American side to the story, not a word in English? It's not like Beyond Rangoon or Because of Platoon or something where you take an American character and you toss him abroad and it becomes, you know, it's not like an American character in the Middle East. This whole film takes place in the Middle East.
Vince Vaughn is a Palestinian in Israel.
Well, he suggested, would you consider Tom Hanks? And I said, look, if Tom Hanks plays the main role, it's good for me because it gives a lot of notoriety to the projects. My salary is 5 times bigger, but it's not going to be believable. Why would an Israeli-Palestinian make the film in English? Unless the story of a Palestinian who was born in the United States, studied medicine in the United States, decided to come back, and then we understand why he has to speak English, because his native tongue become English. But that's not the case.
Right.
So he agreed that it should be in Arabic and Hebrew. And then when I asked him, why are you interested to make the film? He said, I am personally concerned about this conflict. I do like this part of the world.
Mm.
So we agreed. I come back. 2006, a month later, after me and the screenwriter Joel Tubin started writing together, the war happens between Hezbollah and Israel. And I don't know if you remember, that was a damn nasty battle. It was really hard. I mean, I've been through a lot of wars before. The 73, the 82 invasion, and everything, you know. This was peculiarly rough because the bombing was very strong and it was very intense psychologically. So we didn't think we would be able to continue writing the screenplay because it was so intense and it was not happening 10,000 miles. It was happening 500 yards from our house, the bombing. So we had to escape to the mountains a couple of days, thinking that maybe it would be easier. Then it did not work. Then we came back. 33 days later, the war was over, and we continued working.
So the bombing is happening near your home, and you're like,
I swear,
let's get away and write.
I swear. but what the irony about it, there were times where the electricity would be cut off because of the bombing, and we switched to UPS, these uninterrupted power supply for our laptop, and we'd be working on the screenplay, and then the electricity would come back, and then we would wash live, Hassan Nasrallah coming on TV and says, in few seconds, you're going to see how the Israeli boat, we're going to sink it. And then you would see the rocket, the boat would sink, and we go back and write. It was that ironic. But
Are you used to war situations?
I was used to war situations, but I was used to when I was a teenage.
Mm-hmm.
When you're an adult, it takes a different impact. It's you take it more seriously. When you're a teenage, all you care about is when the bombing stops, you can go out and get laid. You can go out and smoke a joint or have fun with your friends. Go party. As an adult, you do think about those things, actually. But you do. But that's not the thing. The thing is your mortality becomes more prevalent because you are aware of the danger. And I that was 33 days of battle in Beirut that equaled all the years that I've lived during the Civil War, which was much longer, much bigger, much more dangerous. But this one just affected. Anyway, we finished.
But you don't ever think let's fly to Connecticut and finish the script?
Maybe. Next one.
Okay.
Because I anticipate this thing is not over yet.
Yeah.
But after we finished the script, we were very happy with it. And things fell apart. Again, I can't discuss all the reasons.
And that's when it became a secret.
Yeah.
So it didn't start as a secret.
In a way, I'm not supposed to.
Right, I understand, but it just...
But anyway, we
the film. But it wasn't like there was some sort of like a Jewish guy in New York who was wanting to finance this but didn't want to be known, and the whole thing started as kind of nefarious, whatever. The deal became a problem, and you guys... You weren't supposed to talk about it anymore.
What you said, there was some partially true to it, but not totally true.
Okay.
I mean, because I think at the bottom of the line, that company decided to back out of the project because they felt it was a bit problematic as a subject. Not because the president of the company disagreed with the subject. I don't think so, because the script is it is a good script. I think we nailed it this time. I think it was for him a marketing strategy that was too much. It's a landmine for him.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I heard it from one of those guys in that company. Says it was considered too pro-Palestinian for an American audience and too pro-Israeli for a European audience, which is a weird thing to say about a film. It's too pro-Israeli for this, but too pro-Palestinian for this.
Kind of means you did your job.
In a way, it shows that you walked a fine line, but I think the story goes beyond pro-hate or pro-that. I think that the story is mainly about this main character who really is looking for the truth. We constantly set up to do a love story, actually. And during the editing, during the writing, you just would add a little bit shots in there, and then suddenly it would take a bigger view of the love story this man has for his wife who committed an atrocious act. But it was a very delicate balance to do. Anyway, this company pulled out. they did not want to do the movie. Then it took 2-3 years of negotiation with a new French company that I've worked, that I did my first film was Beirut. Mm-hmm. And they entered, that they said, we really want to do this movie, but we have to recuperate the rights of the script. Mm-hmm. So it took 3 years of negotiation and money involvement and everything. And then finally we got the money. We got the script back. And mm-hmm. then we had to spend another year looking for the funding. And that's mm-hmm. what became really also very difficult mm-hmm. because the French, who usually put money in this, they did not. And then finally we got the Qatari to put the money.
But you think political reasons again?
Or? No, because the Qatari at that time, just last year, they came up with a big program.
Well, I mean the French, not putting money in.
No, the French Arte said no, and the French Foreign Ministry said no. And those two were very likely to put money on that type of film because mm-hmm. it's their cultural, it's the, up their alley. Right. They didn't do it because they never tell you why they didn't, but my producer, who knows them very, he says, really believe it's a very touchy subject. It is a very touchy subject, but so what? What if it's a touchy subject? I mean, a lot of films are very touchy subjects.
Well, the interesting thing is, I think, as you were saying before, there's a universality to the story, you know, even beyond that particular conflict. There is this, you know, any person with a wife or a husband can identify with the idea of this.
Probably. I mean, you take the idea of love and betrayal between a man and his wife, and you add to it a little bit of a context, like the Israelis and the Palestinians, yeah. You're heightening it a little
bit. It's something that somebody in your life is holding on to from the past. You know, you meet somebody and they're at their 30s or whatever, and you know, you don't know what they did when they were 20 and kind of stuff may be hanging around.
There's always secrets about a couple. And in fact, sometime during the writing, I would sit down with the co-screenwriter who happened to be my wife, and we discussed it, and then we would ask about certain secrecy had happened. I mean, mm-hmm. do you really know that person? You think you know that person. You think the idea of happiness, it's very relative. What pleases this person does not necessarily mean that that's what the other person wants. And this is the whole idea of this book, which was so brilliantly written, mm-hmm. where the character is constantly on good faith. He believes that he has done all he can to make his wife happy. Mm-hmm. He was wealthy, she's beautiful, he built this house, best career in the world. Mm-hmm. Yet this is not what she wanted. It had to take him the whole voyage in that movie to realize that at the end. And this mm-hmm. is where what was great about this novel is this is what the issue. Now you add to it the Palestinian Israeli thing, you could put it in mm-hmm. Ireland, it would still probably work. You would put it in Nicaragua, probably it would work, mm-hmm. probably. But there were some very, very strong positions in the book. This is a great novelist, you know, when mm-hmm. he can find the right word to elaborate what's inside of you. And he really spoke to me. But anyway, it was a very difficult journey to make this movie because the financing was very difficult and not because of the political aspect. Mm-hmm. The Israelis were fine, the Palestinians were fine. They didn't, everybody worked together. Nobody gave a shit. They wanted a movie.
So was it, the reason you didn't want to do it in the first place, was it because it was Middle Eastern material? Were you trying to push away from that in general?
I am trying to push away from it because my producer is having, you know, it's difficult to make films from the Middle East mm-hmm. because the subject is a sensitive subject. This is an unresolved thing. Then also, there are, you know, the funnel is getting narrower. Mm. It really is. I mean, there are more and more films that get made that don't get released. More films that don't get made. They only do the festival circuit. More films mm-hmm. get made. They ended up in DVD. So, in general, I'm speaking. And films about the Middle East are even harder, you know, because the subject is sensitive. Because I am very glad that we managed to make this film and have it sold all over the world. I'm not bragging about the project. It just, mm-hmm. believe me, it's not the common thing to have that, to have a film like this being picked up by Focus Features and by mm-hmm. Cohen Media Group to release it.
So how was production for you?
Look, the people tend to think if you film in Israel with the Palestinian Israelis, it's going to be difficult. It was not difficult. It was an easy thing. My struggle is not any unique from any other directors who's doing film mm-hmm. on a very, very, very tight budget. You know, we had to struggle to make this film made and constantly, because the budget was originally budgeted for $4.5 million to $5 million. We did it for 1.5. The producer came to me and says, we can only raise 1.5. Do you want to make it or not? What would I say? After 5 years of waiting and fighting to get the script back, do you say no? You say, fuck, we're going to do it. No matter what it takes, we're going to do it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, at the end, you're tired, but people pulled through. You know, the crew worked hard. They worked for very reduced rates. The French, the Belgium, the Israelis, and the Palestinians, everybody, like, they said, we really want to do this. And what was the interesting part of it is the Lebanese working with the Israelis. It's never happened. This is the first time. It's actually illegal for Lebanese to set foot in Israel.
So did you sneak people in? Was that?
No, I was the only one who left Lebanon, because Lebanese law dictates that if you work with any Israeli, culturally, politically, financially, you get penalized 3 years in jail with hard labor. So I am not allowed, suppose you're an Israeli today, I am not allowed to even be standing in the same room with you or have a photograph of us. You can't. This is the law. So it's an archaic, stupid law, but the law forbids Lebanese citizen completely to be in any contact on any level, on any world, with any Israeli citizen.
So can you go home?
Well, I went home four or five times since I ended the film. For some reason, the authority have not gotten the case yet. And it's a risk that I'm willing to take. Every time I go, I wonder if this time is my time. But I think also the Lebanese government is smarter than arresting a filmmaker. If I was collaborating with the Israelis, spying for them, I get the death penalty. That's unquestionable. Or I get 25 years in jail, hard labor, whatever. But they are not going to come today. Lebanon, the Lebanese government was trying to improve its image abroad, that we nurtured the cultures, we're nurtured the artists, and we are, you know, freedom of expression. It's trying to sign all these agreements. If they come and arrest me today, which legally they could, but if they come and do it, then they would be screwed. You know, I think there will be a reaction all over the world, especially that I'm an American citizen also, and I'm a French citizen also. So I don't think they would want to have those two government calling the Lebanese government, says, well, you arrest Ziad Doueiri just because he went and fell in Israel. It's stupid. But it's something that I am conscious of it, but I'm more conscious of it psychologically than legally.
Yeah.
Because I have been so scrutinized by that. And just before yesterday, the Lebanese government banned officially the film. Not because they hated it, because I work with Israeli actors. I shot in Israel, and that's a taboo. That's a total taboo. Like, you can't do that.
So how much of an issue was this going into making the movie for you?
Well, before I left, my mother is a lawyer. Mm-hmm. We had a long call. She says, is there a way you can avoid all this quagmire by going shooting someplace else? Go shoot in Tunis, Tunisia, shoot in Cyprus. We have no problem with it. I said, but I need to shoot in the real places. I need to shoot in Tel Aviv. I need to shoot with Israeli actors. I ain't going to go pick an Egyptian actor and have him pretend he's Israeli.
Right.
It does not work anymore. You know, the audience demand some minimum sophistication and minimum truth, authenticity. So we did not know how to encounter that problem. Finally, my mom said, we're going to write a letter. We're going to stamp it by the government and send it to the authorities and ask them to guide us. So we wrote a letter telling them, me, Ziad Doueiri, I'm planning to go film in Tel Aviv, and we need to be there because of authenticity issues. We would like to have your advice on it. How would you like to guide us? I sent the letter. I got a return stamp that it was received because it's a certified letter. And I waited 10 days. Nobody answered. So I said, okay, I'm getting out of here. So I made my bag and I went and I filmed there. And I kept it hush-hush during the time there. But then, you know what? Can I tell you something, David? At a certain point, you say, I do not want to live in hiding. I do not want to hide it. Because it's not a crime to go film. It's a crime not to do it when you have the opportunity to do it. People should judge the film on its merit. Not because I went and shot in Israel. Who the fuck cares where did I shoot? You understand?
Yeah.
It's like you guys want to have political issue, you have it. We're having artistic issue. This is our problem. Don't deal with it. So right now I was very, very disappointed because I really wanted this film to play in Beirut. Really, because this is where the film have the most impact. The Western audience will look at the film and they will look at it from an outside point of view. from a semi-emotional point of view, that may, you know, they will look at it as a fiction. The Arabic population will not look at it purely fiction. They would look at it as a reflection on their lives. Mm-hmm. They will look at it at the first degree. You understand? It speaks to them a lot more than an American or European audience. Mm. So it was really important for me to show it in Beirut. It's my home country anyway. It's where I care about this place. I care about my home. I care about my people a lot. Even though everybody's saying, look, it's okay, it's selling all over the world, forget about Lebanon. Next one. And I'm saying, no, I got to fight for it. I want to show it where it's supposed to be shown. Mm. I am part of that culture. I lived through what they lived through also. It's important, this thing. And now the government banned it. So what the fuck, I don't know what I'm going to do.
So have you have you been there for screenings in other parts of the...
No, we have not screened it yet.
So you've screened it in Israel or...
It's going to be screening in Israel in the summer 2013.
Yeah. So you have no idea what the reaction will be from...
All I know so far, we screened it in the Moroccan Film Festival, which we won the prize, and we screened it in Dubai, two Arabic countries. Mm-hmm. We were wondering, I was a bit, not nervous, but I was anxious to find out how the Arabic audience is going to react. And overall, the audience was very responsive to the film. Nobody walked out, nobody threw eggs, because it could go out that way. But I understand that some of the audience had voiced their dismay, but not because of the film itself. It's because they, some of them said, especially some Palestinian directors actually, and Palestinian people in the arts, they said it was a shame because I showed the Israeli perspective. Because the film is not anti-Israeli or anti-Palestinian. It's not pro-Israeli, neither pro-Palestinian. It walks its own line. And some of the Palestinians said that, why do you show, for example, children, Israeli children being killed in a restaurant, and you don't show what the Israeli do with the Palestinian kids? I said, but I understand that. There is, of course, but this is not the story. The story is about a woman, a Palestinian woman, who blew herself up in a restaurant with kids, with Israeli kids. They say, how come you show Jenin when the doctor goes and then he walks over the rubble, and you don't show people with ambulances and wounded? I said, because this is not the story. So they were trying to create a parallel, and they were, some of them were like really upset that the Israeli was not portrayed as the biggest evil. It's not interesting to portray anybody as the pure evil for that film.
I find this to be the truth, a truth about liberal audiences in this country, particularly. You go to Sundance, you go to some of these festivals, and if the film is gray, not black and white, but it's a gray story, and you don't somehow say that whoever the flavor of black is at that moment, that's bad, say they're evil. They're the evil ones.
That's right.
People get very upset. Even you would think that in a liberal room that it would be like, you know, okay, we're open to the thinking about things.
That's right.
But they get very angry that you haven't said, you know, this guy is bad, this guy is good.
That's right.
Isn't very strange funny? Phenomenon.
I know. It's a reaction to, you know, when you become, there is some conservative in the liberal movement also. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You understand? I mean, you would expect that the artists be the people who are the most open about it, accepting to look at the other side, no matter what the other side has done. But sometimes it's not the case, especially in this conflict.
Yeah.
So.
Well, there's a documentary this year called The World According to Dick Cheney that was, you know, centrally an interview with Dick Cheney. And there are people in this country despise Dick Cheney, particularly on the left, but... people were really enraged that it wasn't more of an angry, you know, a piece about what an asshole Dick Cheney is. It was him being allowed to speak. And it was like, isn't it interesting to see what this guy actually thinks as opposed to just seeing another movie condemning him? I mean, that's not so hard to do.
That's right. But seen it before.
Yeah.
We've seen films talking about the Israeli occupation and Israeli oppression and Israeli racism. All that, we know it. Nobody's going to contest it. I can assure you, even the Israeli themselves, when they wake up in the morning and look at themselves in the mirror while they are shaving, most of them, in the back of their mind, they know that they have occupied an entire population. It's not a secret. They know it. I don't even have to say it. They know it. I've heard it so many times among the Israelis that I was working with. They kept us. He says, we know what we've done is not right, but there's always a but.
There are reasons for it.
But yeah. Yes, but they know what they have done is unethical. Mm-hmm. They know it. We don't have to debate it. Period. Everybody's pro-Palestinian today. Mm-hmm. Even the hardline Israeli could, in a way, look at it. The discourse has changed throughout the years, fortunately. But everybody knows that. I mm-hmm. wanted to go a little bit beyond because the book was great. The book was so fantastic. It talks about an incredible human suffering, having lost everything, having reached the peak of his career. At the first 5 minutes of the film, mm-hmm. he's on top. That's it. I've made it. And then it's the fall toward the deepest pit he could ever imagine. And this is what I like about the story. You take your mm-hmm. character and you stonewall him from beginning till end. And that was interesting about it. I really, really liked that book. In fact, I went and I read all his other books. Mm-hmm. The guy is a brilliant writer. Yasmina Kadra is phenomenal.
So your mom is sounds like she's a pretty cool woman.
My mom is such an extremist that this is what I loved about her. My mom is an extremist. She's very radical. Hmm. I inherited that extremism part about her. And I inherited some stuff from my dad, but mainly I inherited my mom is a fanatical woman. Not in the wrong sense. She's a hardliner. You know, she's involved right now. She's a lawyer, and so she's involved a lot into the equality between the genders. That in Lebanon, there's a law, if you're a woman, and you cannot pass your citizenship to your son. The citizenship always goes through the father. You understand? So my mom is being very involved in that. My mom mm-hmm. represented the NOW, if you remember, the National Organization of Women. Mm-hmm. Well, she was representing them in the Middle East also. She's been very, very active, very politically active, and very left-wing liberal too, very mm-hmm. anti-clerical. Is the lawnmower screwing us up?
No, we love the lawnmower.
Okay. So.
Just think of it as bombing in the background, it's okay.
I would. So, she had an incredible influence on me in my life, my mom.
And she
still does. That mom still does until now.
Well, it sounds like she was part of getting this movie made.
She had her own worries also, but my mom raised us to be so determined in this because she had to struggle also.
Always supportive as you as a filmmaker?
A lot, tremendously. When I finished high school in Beirut, my dad wanted me to go to France and study filmmaking because for my dad, France is closer to Lebanon. Mm-hmm. America is too far, you know, and they hated the American politics, everything. He wanted, mm-hmm. my mom said he should go study in America. It costs 10 times more, but it's better. She did not know why, but she just believed it's better to go study in the US. And then they struggled a lot to pay for my college in California. Mm-hmm. I owe my parents so much, you know, it's.
What made you think that being a filmmaker was really an option for you?
It's not an option.
You mean it's a drive, is it calling or?
You know, I got asked a lot that questions. You don't know why you don't know what motivates you to become a filmmaker. If I'm going to start trying to intellectualize and try to find a reason, it will be banal.
But there wasn't really a Lebanese film culture as such.
You're kidding?
Grew up, was there?
Not at all.
Right.
But what do you think in the 70s we were getting, or in this, growing up 70s and 80s?
Our stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Everything. And we were getting a lot of stuff. I mean, the film would be released on Monday in the United States. Mm-hmm. Friday was playing in Beirut. It's the only thing that got us, that made me almost, the only form of entertainment in Lebanon at that time. Mm-hmm. You know, we had great movie theaters at that time, and film were not just from the United States. Mm-hmm. We had film from Europe, we had from erotic films all the time coming from Italy, Lando Buzanca and all that stuff, you know, the titties film.
How do those play in Lebanon?
You see, Lebanon back in the 70s, we were kicking ass. We were such a great place because we were pluralistic society, half Christian, half Muslims. Nobody dominated, really. We had an exchange of ideas. Even the Palestinians' presence in Lebanon, which was not always positive because they were very militant and very armed to the teeth. Mm-hmm. But they brought in a lot of ideas. Lebanon in the 60s and 70s produced a lot of ideas. We were the beacon in the Middle East. We were really like on the same level as the Israelis in terms of cultural exchange. We're producing music and theaters and books and everything. And movie theater were coming, were always so packed. What do you think? I saw Rumblefish. Blade Runner. Mm. All the, you know, all the films that you have seen, there's not a single film that hasn't, you have, it always there. The desire to make films started there, I don't know. I can never answer that question. It doesn't matter. Maybe earlier, I don't know. Mm-hmm. Maybe, it's just they love to want to tell a story. I think it starts that way. I really don't know. It's the questions that it would be so stupid and banal if I answer you. When did it all start?
Well, did you know that you were going to be a director? Was that the thing that was...
Because when I left Beirut and I came to study, I was planning to work as a cameraman.
SC or UCLA or...?
I went to San Diego and then I moved to Los Angeles.
Okay.
So I wanted to work as a director of photography. That was my thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I started as a grip, then an electrician, pushed dolly, did some lab training. I used to go to Photocam, Technicolor, Deluxe, just to learn about, you know, I'm telling you, mid-80s.
Mm-hmm.
When I graduated, and then I was just working. I wanted to do the job, and slowly I started to make my way around, got to work on student film, and then I started getting to work on feature film. I think the first film that I've done was a Roger Corman film, and it was called The Munchies. And The Munchies was the exact film as The Gremlins.
Oh, I remember. Did they come out of the toilet? Was that the one where the...
That's right.
I remember that.
It's just the cheap version of The Gremlins. You know, you have Bob Zemeckis doing this, and then you have his editor, Bettina Hirsch, who edited The Gremlins, who was giving a little bit of money to do the cheap version of The Gremlins. This is The Munchies. That was my first feature I've ever done. But I can't tell you how much I learned from it. You know, because I started making my whole learning filming experience on... I work on a film called Rollerblade Warrior. Have you heard of that film?
I don't know that I know that one.
I beat you on that one. There was a guy, his name's Don Jackson, okay? This guy would make a movie in 4 days on $50,000 budget. And we were very well paid by it. We were four people of us making the movie. There were more actors than crew. And he was living in Hollywood.
This is still with celluloid. This is not even...
Yeah, no, there was no digital. You're kidding. Nothing. Yeah. It was pure 35 millimeter. I would go to Hollywood, Aaron Emmons, check the cameras, and he would have two lenses, an 18 millimeter and a 300 millimeter, and we'd carry everything. And we would go on the street and shoot those films in 4 days, 5 days. And they had an incredible audience. It would all go to DVD, to VHS at that time. It's funny saying VHS. Something we're going to forget then. It would go to VHS, but it had all its underground cult following those movies. Roller Blade Warrior 1, 2, Death Come to Frogtown.
That I know.
Yeah. So all this niche of the films, I was getting a lot of my hands working on with this weird guy called Don Jackson that nobody heard. Film it in 1 week, 5 days. And I was doing camera assistant, lighting, grip, everything. We were four of us doing that. I learned so... People think... They always ask me about working with Quentin Tarantino.
Right.
And I love the experience with him, but it's more memorable working on those trashiest film in 1 week where I was, you know, still out of college, just do everything. You know, you toss everything in the back of the pickup truck and go shoot. Jump all over. You do 60 setup a day.
Well, I haven't done that. You probably know that you can do everything.
I learned a lot from it. I learned so much from it. And I still have fond memories of it because... You know, for an immigrant from Beirut, you come and you say, you know, you struggled a lot. Your parents put their money for you to get an education. You want to do the best. You want to be able to be at the forefront of filmmaking.
Mm-hmm.
For the first couple of years, when I was doing those films, I was not at the forefront. I was doing the B-series film, the C-series film, okay? Mm-hmm. There was a time where I was psychologically a little bit perturbed. Because did I immigrate and studied to go these movies? Today, 20 years later, I think of those moments so fondly. I wish I could relive them because I was, you know, I was living almost this, going to shoot on Hollywood Boulevard at night, people who are so weird, living underground like bats.
Mm-hmm.
You know, at that time, I felt like maybe I'm gonna end up doing pornography. Next step looks like you're going to go to pornography. You understand?
Just go right over the hill. Yeah,
you feel like this is how you started. You really fucked up your career. You went to college. Your mom and your dad struggled for you to do those kind of movies. That's it. I don't have luck. But today when I think about him, I'm talking about it.
Well, you only lose your virginity once, you know.
Yeah,
once,
that's right.
You can only have that thrill of the first time, the one, you know.
Yeah.
And that was it. I feel the same way myself. There was a time when I worked for a TV show when I was, you know, little, 20 years old, and worked like 85-hour weeks, and it was crazy, and it was difficult, and I wasn't in charge, and all that, but best time I can ever remember working.
Yeah, but you realize it later in life, not at that time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you've had the journey, but now this is your, are you going on to another film already, or are you still?
Look, there is another film that I've written, also taking place in the Middle East, and it's a much lighter film, much humorous, but it's very political. I'm just wondering if I should get involved in it right now, because it took a toll working, like I said, doing those films. It's hard to finance it, hard to distribute it, hard to justify yourself in front of an audience. I'm just discussing it with my French producer, Jean Brea, and he says, look, why don't you take a break a little bit and do something else? Totally different. Mm-hmm. Something that it's easier for me to finance. Okay? And they are very prominent producers in France. Mm-hmm. You know, they have their weight and their weight. It's still hard for them to do these films. He says, take a break, do something like science fiction.
Romantic comedy.
Anything. And then later you can always go back to it. So I am in a period of my life right now where I'm considering taking a little break from the Middle East, but I know I'll go back to it because it's your guts.
Yeah.
It's your childhood.
But this sets the table nicely for you, I think.
Which one, the attack or the next project?
The attack, in terms of people respecting the work.
I mean,
Beirut also, but...
I am so happy the way things turn out. You understand? When we got a call that the film was selected at Telluride, that was it was not about the prestige of Telluride, I assure you. It was about feeling that all these effort that Joël and I put in had paid back. And it paid back in the greatest way, because I know what Telluride is. I mean, it is just such a awesome way to be invited to that festival. It really, you know, it's nice when you water your plant and you keep putting fertilizers and you have storms that almost uproot your tree. And at the end, after years and years, the tree comes up and gives you a nice little fruit and you buy it and says, God, it tastes good. You know, it's nice to put a lot of effort and get something back from life. And I think The Attack has sold all over the world for a film that 5 years ago was on the shelf, not allowed to get it back because legal reasons. Mm-hmm. Now for it to be sold all over Europe, in America. You know how difficult for American market to buy foreign films? Yeah. It's not easy. How many films come from the Middle East that actually get released here? There are hundreds of films that comes out in this part of the world.
Three a year, about.
Yes, I mean, and the fact that the film was bought by an American distributor all over, in Europe, everywhere. It's been to 17 film festival, which the film is not even released yet.
Mm.
It is nice to say all your effort didn't go in vain. Mm. You understand?
Oh, yeah.
It's not going to be a moneymaker, but it's going to be seen. God, it was worth it sticking, because I lost confidence in myself.
Mm.
I really did. I felt that this thing is... I felt that you work so hard learning the filmmaking process in California. I lived 18 years in Los Angeles working on great movies.
Mm.
There was a time where I felt it's over for me.
Mm.
I felt like, khalas, I would say in Arabic, like, that's it. You're one of the guys who didn't make it. And I started almost considering doing another job, like teaching film or something, or script doctoring or something, which is very depressing. Very, because, and then suddenly, and it's my third film, it's not the first one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you struggle on your first one, the second should be easier, the third should be easier. The third one turned out to be by far the most difficult one. The fact that I'm sitting with you right now is because you've seen it. The fact that you've seen it, that means it's getting its share back from what any filmmakers would expect. And I'm very happy. Let me tell you, it gave me the faith to continue, because there was a time where I swear that I thought, khalas, it's over. And I had a child. You know, I remember in Beirut sitting just 2 years ago, giving the bottle to my child. She was 3 years old when, you know, I'm telling you this, 2 years ago. There was a time where tears start rolling down my cheeks, because I felt all your dreams will never happen, and you won't be able to provide living for your, that little child and for yourself. It's not easy. It's not, you're not in your early 20s, just out of college, wanting to do that movie. My whole existence, me, the screenwriter, Joel, and my the whole thing was up for questioning. It tremendously insecured me. And then, by a twist of things, it just started to happen again. It's not easy, but it's getting its share back. You understand?
Yeah. It's a good story.
Yeah.
It's good to see.
Thank you.